have some good news, and I have some bad news. The bad news is I forgot my notes for the sermon. I went into the room where I had them, and I picked up my flash drive. No, she called me to tell me something about some people next door who were involved in cocaine, and one of them got shot. Totally forgot what I was doing. But the good news is, I have my flash drive with the PowerPoint presentation that I had prepared. And I remember significantly what I was about to do, because part of it is one scripture that is going to be like 13 verses, which I had planned to read because it needs some explanation. So, hopefully I'll be able to, there might be some details that I may not remember, but I think most of what I wanted to say, I can probably recollect, and I made some notes here, at least to find the scripture. So, brethren, we are all today living in interesting times. Interesting because we are all witnesses to two events that have prophetic fulfillment. The first of which is a statement made by Mr. Herbert W. Armstrong that Germany will be united. All of us here, brethren, are living in those times. Some of us may not have been born at the time, or can't remember at the time that they were united, which was somewhere in 1989, when the youth of East Germany scaled the Berlin Wall. One Saturday night, I think it was. And eventually broke down the wall at a point called Checkpoint Charlie, which is where access to East Germany from West Germany was facilitated. Because following the Second World War, Germany was divided between the Russians, who grabbed the part that is called East Germany, and the Allies, primarily the United States, which liberated Germany from Nazi occupation, the death camps, etc. But they stopped at a point, maybe about one-fifth of Germany was now in East Germany, was called East Germany, and was occupied by the Russians. So they broke down the wall from that point, and then all the soldiers who formerly would have shot anybody attempted to cross that wall simply stood by and did nothing. And from that incident, Germany became united today. So all of us here are living in that time group. The second prediction that he made was that Britain will not remain in Europe, whatever political organization. And he said that at a time when Britain had joined what was then, I think, the European coal and steel. And he based these two predictions on prophetic statements. First of all, in the case of Germany, by knowing who they are and their role and function in Europe over the past millennia or two, their immediate history, and knowing something about the character of the German people. And secondly, in the case of Britain, by being able to identify who they are in the Bible, as far as their national identity and therefore their future is concerned. And based on these understandings, he was able to make two predictions that we are witnessing today. So I thought I would go into some of these and let us see how he came up with some of these predictions. Let us look at the case, first of all, with Britain, since it's the most recent. The identity of Britain according to that prediction, was rooted in prophecies that were given to Abraham and his descendants. Now, Abraham lived in the land of Ur of the Chaldees, which is somewhere around Babylon, Iraq today. And God told him one day, and we can, let's go to Genesis chapter 12. God told Abraham, it says, "Now the Lord had said to Abraham, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation. And I will bless you, and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless you, and curse him who curses you. And in thy seed, in thee, shall all the families of the earth be blessed." So Abraham left, and he went to this land that God had shown him. Now, verse 7 says, "And the Lord appeared unto Abraham and said, unto thy seed will I give this land? And he showed him a vast expanse of land." But Abraham at that time was childless. He had no child. His wife Sarah was barren. And so somewhere along the road, perhaps trying to, he was getting down in age, so too was his wife. She decided, "Well, I can't have children, so take my handmaid, see if you can have a child with her." And he did. And he called him Esau.
Ishmael.
Oh, sorry, Ishmael. Yeah. He called him Ishmael. But God said, "No, you know, Ishmael will not be your heir. Your child will come from your loins," meaning from your marital relationship, not an outside thing like that. And when Abraham was nearly 100 years old, God fulfilled that prophecy, and a son was born to him. So I guess God was trying to make Abraham be aware of that, listen, what I am going to do here is not something natural. Because his wife was nearly 90 years old, and they said past childbearing age. And she had a child at 90 years old. Abraham at 100 years old. And then when this child was maybe about 9, 10 years old, God told Abraham to go sacrifice him. And Abraham attempted to do just that. And as he was about to plunge the knife into the boy's chest, or to cut his throat, an angel stopped him. And based on that incident, God decided to increase the blessings that he was going to give to Abraham. He added other things to it. Now the blessings went on. They were passed from Abraham to his son, born of his marriage, Isaac. And from Isaac, they were transferred to Isaac's two children. Now Isaac had two boys. They were twins, I think. Jacob and Esau. Esau, as the Bible said, there would be two nations from the womb. Esau would be different, a wild man, kind of. He loved to hunt. Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents, etc. And somewhere along the line, when Isaac was getting old and he was about to die, he called Esau and told him to go and get some venison. As they say, he loved wild meat. Go and hunt, get some venison, cook it, and bring it for me, let me eat. So I'm going to die happy with my son's venison. Now, their mother, Rebecca, overheard that conversation between Jacob and, between Isaac. Isaac and his son Esau. And she told Joseph, because she favored Joseph. Isaac loved, as as it said, Isaac loved Esau. And Rebecca, the mother, loved Jacob. So when she heard that, she told him to go get two goats, which I suppose don't taste too much differently from wine meat. And she killed them, cooked it just the way the father liked it, got Jacob to dress up in his brother's clothes, put on animal skins around his neck, and he went in. Now Isaac felt that something was funny, because he said that the voice is the voice of Jacob. So he said, come closer to me, my son, and kiss me. You know, they do the kiss. And when he went close, he smelled. He said, it smells like Esau. He touched him, he felt the hairy hands. He says, you know, it smells like Esau. Okay, probably is Esau. Walks like a duck, quacks like a duck. It probably is a duck. So here's what happened. Let's go to Genesis chapter 22 and see what transpired. Something here I want to point out. Let's go from verse 15. It says, and the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time, and said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord. For because thou hast done this thing, the incident with Isaac that he was attempting to sacrifice, and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore. And note this, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in thy seed shall all nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. Now this is the angel of the Lord repeating, thy seed shall possess the gates of his enemies. Now that is echoing a blessing, I suppose, or a goodwill wish, when Rebecca was going to be married to Isaac. The family told her, let thy seed possess the gate of his enemies. Now gate, as they say, translates into sea gates, sea lanes. As we go on, we remember that. We will see how this fits into it. But now let's continue what happened with between Jacob and his brother. Now Isaac got the venison and he ate and he was pleased. Let's go to Genesis chapter 27. Genesis chapter 27, and let's go from, let's start from verse 25. Now, Jacob here is involved in some deception of his father. Verse 24 says, and he said, art thou my very son Esau? And Jacob said, yes, I am. And verse 25, and he said, bring the venison near to me, and I will eat of my son's venison, that my soul may bless thee. And he brought it to him, and he did eat. And he brought him wine, and he drank. And his father Isaac said to him, come near now and kiss me, my son. And he came near and kissed him. And Jacob smelled the smell of his raiment, or Isaac smelled the smell of his raiment, and blessed him. And he said, see, the smell of my son is as the smell of a field which the Lord had blessed. Therefore, God give thee of the dew of heaven. He given him blessings now. And the fatness of the earth, and plenty plenty, not a little bit, plenty of corn and wine. Notice, let people serve thee, and let nations bow down to thee. Be Lord over thy brethren, and let thy mother's sons bow down to thee. Cursed be everyone that curses you, and blessed be he who blesses you. Don't know this. Let nations bow down to you. Why is this significant? Because we will see, as a little bit later, what is the import of let nations bow down to you means. And let people serve thee. And people is not referring to only necessarily a neighbor. But he's talking about let nations serve you. So he died. And Esau swore that when he was dead, after the days of mourning, he was going to kill Jacob. And his mother Sarah heard it. And she told him to get out of here. She sent him to his uncle, Laban. While he was there, he saw Laban's younger daughter. Found she was very pretty. And they say he was smitten. So he went to Laban and said, you know, I would like to marry her. Laban said, fine. But you got to work 7 years. You got nothing. You can't give any dowry. Work for me 7 years, and she's yours. Okay, so he did it. He worked for 7 years, and they said to him, it was like, spent the time, I suppose that's what happens when you love, they say. So the 7 years seemed as nothing. But when the time came for the marriage, his uncle pulled a fast one on him. Remember in those days, women were veiled, etc. You weren't allowed to see the bride before, and apparently not even after. Because after he had consummated the marriage, when he woke the next morning, he saw the elder sister, who apparently was cross-eyed. She wasn't particularly attractive. And so you could imagine what his reaction was. He went to, why have you deceived me like this? He said, well, no, I mean, in our family and stuff, the younger one can't get married before the older one. But if you want to marry the younger one, serve me another 7 years, and it's yours. So he went ahead, and he decided to serve the next 7 years. But in the meantime, you know, he had children with the wife. Then at a certain point in time, the wife ceased to bear, and she gave him one of her handmaids. So he went and he had 2 children with one of the handmaids. And the wife who couldn't bear, her name was Rachel, she also decided, well, you know, to give him her hand, because she also couldn't bear children at that point in time. And he had another 2 kids with the second wife, Rachel's children. Eventually, a situation arose where the first wife, Leah, became fertile again and had a couple more kids. So he had 6 by her. 2 by each of the handmaids, and then of the favorite wife, Rachel, he had 2. The firstborn was Joseph. The second one was called Benjamin. And you would have heard of the incident with Joseph. He gave her pretty clothes. Now, he obviously favored Joseph above all the brothers, which caused resentment. And he compounded it by giving him this pretty coat. And when the brothers saw that, they wanted to kill him. But the eldest brother said, no, we can't let our brother's blood be on our hands. And so he decided, let's throw him in a pit. And they said his plan was to come back and rescue him from the pit. Now that brother was Judah. Now he was not the firstborn. The firstborn was called Reuben. And perhaps for that act of rescuing Joseph, we see a special blessing being put on Judah, Judah from whom came the Jews. So now, there was an incident somewhere late in his life where Jacob wrestled with a man all night until morning. And when the day was breaking, he was still wrestling with the man. The man said to him, let me go. And he said, no, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And he was given the blessing, and his name was changed from Jacob, which meant supplanter, to now Israel, which means one who prevails with God. So the name Israel was now passed to Jacob. There came a time when he was about to die. Let's take a look at that. Let's go to Genesis chapter 48. Perhaps before we go to that, there was an incident that took place. With Joseph, when they threw him in the pit, he took his coat and they cut it up and they threw some animal blood in it. And they told Jacob that an animal had killed him. And you could imagine the impact that would have had on him, because Joseph would have been his firstborn son from his second wife, the life's favorite wife. But they took him and they sold him as a slave into Egypt. And while in Egypt, some prophetic capability that he had demonstrated even while he was a youth began to come into play. And you'd have heard about the famine in Egypt. Pharaoh saw a dream. Jacob interpreted the dream and told him that there would be a famine. And this is what you need to do in order to protect your people. So Pharaoh saw that this is wise counsel, and he put him in charge of implementing whatever it is he said to do, which was to get corn in 7 good years, etc., because the famine is going to be severe. While in Egypt, Joseph, now 30-something years old, about 30 years old, overseeing this thing one day, he saw some people coming, and he looked up, and he recognized his brothers. Now, they, of course, wouldn't recognize him because he was about 17. When they sold him as a slave, he's now about 30 years old, muscled up and totally looking different. Plus, he's wearing an Egyptian outfit. So he saw them, cut the story short, he played a trick on them, eventually revealed who he was, and a prophecy that he had mentioned to his father, that he was in a field where they all were gathering sheaves of wheat, etc., and all his brother's sheaves bowed down to him. And they hated him for that, when he said it. But now here he was, as Pharaoh's right-hand man, as it were, in Egypt. And his brothers came and bowed down before him. Eventually he revealed who he was. He got them to bring his father down. And they lived in Egypt for a lengthy period. Now his father came at a point when he was about to die. And apparently, as the custom was, before fathers died, they passed blessings onto their children. Let's see what these blessings involve. Let's go to Genesis chapter 48. And let's start with verse 1. It said that it came to pass after these things that one told Joseph, "Behold, thy father is sick." And he took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. And one told Jacob and said, "Behold, thy son Joseph cometh unto thee." And Israel, Jacob, now remember his name was changed from Jacob to Israel, strengthened himself and sat up on the bed. And Jacob said unto Joseph, "God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me, and said unto me, Behold, I will make thee fruitful and multiply thee, and I will make of thee a multitude of people, and will give this land to thy seed after thee for an everlasting possession." And now here's what he says. "And now thy two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, which were born unto thee in the land of Egypt before I came unto thee, are mine." Now notice, he isn't just merely adopting them. He's telling Joseph that these two boys that you got, these are not yours. They are mine. As Reuben and Simeon, as your brothers Reuben and Simeon are mine, that is how I am now regarding them. They are mine. As if I have been their father. If you have children after them, they are going to be yours. But these two boys, they're mine. He says, "And thy issue which thou begettest after them shall be thine. And they shall be called after the name of the brethren in their inheritance." But for these two boys, they're mine. And here's what he says. Let's drop down to verse 8. "And Israel," Jacob, "beheld Joseph's two sons and said, Who are these? And Joseph said unto his father, These are my sons, whom God has given me in this place. And Jacob said, Bring them to me, I pray thee, and I will bless them." Now he said, "Now the eyes of Israel were dim for age, so that he could not see." He had cataracts. "And he brought the two boys near to him, and he kissed them and embraced them. And Jacob," Israel, "said to Joseph, I had not thought to see thy face. And lo, God has showed me thy seed." And Joseph brought them out from between his knees. Apparently they were quite young. "And he bowed himself with his face to the earth. And Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand, toward Israel's left hand. And Manasseh in his left hand, towards Israel's right hand." So, Israel, Jacob is like this. He put Manasseh here, Ephraim here. Because Manasseh was the firstborn. It says, "And Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it upon Ephraim's head, who was the younger." So this is what he did. Manasseh here, Ephraim here, he decided to do this instead. And he put his right hand on the head of Ephraim. Who was the younger, and his left hand upon Manasseh's head, who was the elder, guiding his hands wittingly, for Manasseh was the firstborn. And he blessed Joseph and said, "God before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac did walk, the God which fed me all my life long unto this day, the angel which redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads." Who are the lads? Ephraim and Manasseh. "And let my name be named on them." And what was his name? Israel. "And the name of my fathers Abraham and Isaac." And on these two boys, who will now henceforth be called Israel, "let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth. And when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand upon the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. And he held up his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head unto Manasseh's head. And Joseph said unto his father, Not so, my father, for this is the firstborn. Put thy right hand upon his head. And his father refused and said, I know it, my son, I know it. He also shall become a people. And note, he shall also be great. But truly his younger brother shall be greater than he. And his seed shall become a multitude of nations. So out of Ephraim, you're going to have more than one nation. And he blessed them that day, saying, In thee shall Israel bless, saying, God make thee as Ephraim and Manasseh. Not Manasseh and Ephraim, but Ephraim and Manasseh. And he set Ephraim before Manasseh. So here we see that act that Jacob, now known as Israel, performed. He made Manasseh greater than Ephraim. Now he made Ephraim greater than Manasseh. Ephraim was the younger one, and he made Ephraim greater than Manasseh. That has significance because the blessing that would normally have gone to the firstborn, Manasseh, the greater part of the blessing was now going to go to Ephraim, who was the younger, which is not the normal thing. So he's doing something unusual. Now, he said, Thy seed shall become a people, but truly his younger brother shall be greater than him. So if Manasseh is going to be great, and Ephraim is going to be greater, we're dealing with something unusual. We're dealing with the two greatest nations that are going to be on the earth. Now, chapter 49. And Jacob called unto his sons and said, Gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days, so that the blessings were not going to happen to them shortly thereafter. It was going to happen in the last days. Let's drop down and look at verse. Now he's going in order. He went to Reuben, my firstborn. Verse 3. Reuben, my firstborn, and my might, the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity and the excellency of power, unstable as water, thou shalt not excel. Because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, thou defiled. He went up to my couch. He had sex with his father's concubine. And for that, the quote-unquote blessing, or the predictive thing that the father said, thou shalt not excel. And then he went to Simeon, who was again born from his first wife. Simeon and Levi are brethren. Instruments of cruelty are they in their habitations. They went and they slew hundreds of people from a neighboring different group of people because the son had raped their daughter, their sister. And they got the men to go get circumcised. And while they were so, Levi and Simeon grabbed their swords and went down and they slaughtered every man jack in that tribe, at least in that particular location. And he says, you know, they slew a man, and in their self-will they dig down a wall. Cursed be their anger, for it was fierce, and their wrath and their anger, for it was cruel. I will divide them in Israel, in Jacob, and scatter them in Israel. And here's what he said to Judah. Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies. Thy father's children shall bow down before thee. Judah is a lion's whelp from the prey, my son. Thou art gone up, he stooped down, he couches a lion, crouching to spring. as an old lion who shall rouse him. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come. And unto him shall be the gathering of the people be. And if you go and you look at the rest of the blessings, you will find that for the other sons, they're really trivial. Naphtali is a hind let loose. He gives goodly words. Some say we can identify Naphtali today with Geneva, with Switzerland, where you have all of these conferences that you have in Geneva. Gives goodly words. They have the Geneva conference. When they have OPEC countries, etc., or they want to have reconciliation between countries, they bring them to Geneva. How prisoners of war should be treated, especially civilians, the Geneva Convention, and how soldiers should be treated, etc., all these things come out of Geneva. And then he went back to Ephraim and Manasseh and added some other things to them. Let's drop down to He says, Joseph is a fruitful bough. Now remember, Joseph is the father of Ephraim and Manasseh. So when he says Joseph, he's speaking to Ephraim and Manasseh. Joseph is a fruitful bough, even a fruitful bough by a well, whose branches run over the well. And if you can imagine a vine, let's say a pumpkin vine, watermelon vine, by a well. It has access to a lot of water. So it is going to run over the well and spread out. And will bear a lot of fruit. So this is the analogy he's drawing. Whose branch run over the wall? The archers have sorely grieved him and shuddered him and hated him. But his bow abode in strength, and the arms of his hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. From thence is the shepherd, the stone of Israel. Verse 25, even by the God of thy father who shall help thee, and by the Almighty who shall bless thee, you will note the blessings of heaven above, and blessings of the deep that lies under, and blessings of the breasts and of the womb. The blessings of thy father have prevailed above the blessings of my progenitors unto the utmost bound of the everlasting hills. They shall be on the head of Joseph and on the crown of the head of him that was separate from his brethren. So here he is now providing additional blessings to Ephraim and Manasseh. And they were both going to be great. But now he said, these blessings were going to be in the last days, the latter days. Now, there are two brothers. The blessings that were given to them meant that they would be the two greatest nations the world has ever seen. Ephraim, he put Ephraim ahead of Manasseh, so Ephraim would have his ascendancy apparently a little bit before. Now, what two countries are we aware of who became great, who were brothers, and became the two greatest nations the world had ever seen? Within our lifetime, the greatest country we have seen is the United States. But remember, the United States were formed after Britain. Lots of people from Britain and other places settled there. And it was this prophecy that Mr. Armstrong interpreted that Ephraim represented the British people and Manasseh represented the United States. It wasn't fulfilled between Spain and Portugal because, first of all, Spain and Portugal were part of the Roman Empire. So that when Spain was having colonies, they were under the, really, the domination of the Habsburg Empire. So Spain was not, quote unquote, an independent country. They were part of the Holy Roman Empire. Portugal likewise, which was why you found that when they were competing for territory, the Pope, I don't remember his name at this point, but he made a treaty called Tordesillas, that the Pope assigned to Spain all territories west of the Azores, meaning all on the territories on this side, because Brazil, remember, is Portuguese. So to avoid the conflict that would have emerged between them, after Portugal had acquired Brazil, the Pope made that decision. And therefore, that is why you have no more Portuguese colonies here. And they went to the other side. They went to Africa. They had Angola, Namibia, I think. They went to Goa in the middle, in the East Asia there. They had a few colonies there. But Spain and Portugal could never be really considered brothers. They lived next to one another in the Iberian Peninsula, but were never really considered brothers. So according to this prophecy by Mr. Armstrong, because Britain is Ephraim and Manasseh is the United States, it was based on that, he said, that they would leave the common market. Because the European Coal and Steel, and then the European Economic Union, the EEC, and now to the European Union, based on prophecy, he determined that the European Union was the beginning of a revival of the Roman Empire. And because, as a consequence of Ephraim and Manasseh being given this these blessings by God, there was a prediction that if you will not obey me, I will break the pride of your power. That was stated by God. And as we say, we can't find too many nations who are determined not to follow what God says. The prophecy that let thy seed possess the gates of his enemies. Let's see how that was fulfilled. Now the gates, remember, we said are sea gates, trading, important trading corridors. United States had Panama and Trinidad and Tobago. And remember, Trinidad and Tobago was vital during the Second World War because of the Nazi U-boats or submarines going down to South America, which is why they got Chagaramas, because from Chagaramas they could monitor the sea lanes where they would pass. Britain had the Cape of Good Hope under South Africa. They have the Suez Canal. They have Gibraltar. They had Singapore. I think at one time they had the Bosphorus. And they had significant influence in the Gulf of Aden. So a lot of places where trade, and especially oil. And one of the blessings that was given to them involved control of these. But because of disobedience, the prophecy was that God would take these things away. Britain has lost the Cape of Good Hope. They've lost the Suez Canal. Gamal Abdel Nasser, president of Egypt, seized it. And they still have Gibraltar today, but there's now a conflict between them and Spain. Spain is demanding the return of Iraq. And with the Brexit taking place, it could very well be that the people of Gibraltar may decide to stay within the EU. They gave up Singapore, And of course, they launched the Bosphorus to Turkey. So all of these gates that they possess, they have lost. The United States gave up Panama. But the Panama, the Chinese now control it. He also predicted that Denmark, Norway, and Sweden will not be part of the final revival of the Roman Empire. So now, how did he come to the conclusion that Germany would be part of the Roman Empire, or that there would be a Roman Empire once again? Germany was always a part of the Roman Empire. If you study their history, you will find that many German emperors, many German tribes were involved in the European Union, or the Roman Empire at that time. And he made that prediction based upon certain prophecies. Let's go to the first, well, to one of these prophecies. Let's go to Revelation 13. He said, "And I stood on the sand of the sea," verse 1, "and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns. And upon his head, the name of blasphemy." And now he begins to describe us to the beast. Describe the beast to us. "And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard." I've done a PowerPoint presentation. Let's see what this beast looks like. Let's see the first one. "The beast which I saw was like unto a leopard." Well, let's see what this beast could possibly look at. Beast was like unto a leopard. Now don't do the automatics in. You put them in because it will run longer than or quicker than I. So just do that one with a leopard. "And his feet were as the feet of a bear." So let's see the next image with the feet of a bear. They went one in order. So the next one is the feet of a bear. Right. Feet of a bear. "And his mouth as the mouth of a lion." So let's see that next image with the mouth of a lion. And we'll hold it there for now. It says, "And the dragon," an entity called the dragon, "gave him his power and his seat and great authority." And verse 3, he said, "And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death." Now, he gave us here, there are 7 heads. But he's only telling us that we can be sure of at this point, the head of a lion, because he saw the mouth of a lion. In order to see the mouth, you've got to have the head. He doesn't give us a description of the other heads. He just said, "Look like a leopard, look like a bear, look like a lion." And then there was another head. But no description was given to him. "But one of the heads was wounded to death, and the deadly wound was healed." Well, let's go to the next image. One of the heads was wounded to death, and the deadly wound was healed. "And the world, all the world, wondered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon which gave power unto the beast. And they worshipped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him," the beast now, that day, after the deadly wound was healed, "a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given to him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. power was given him over all kindreds and towns and nations, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. It says, if any man has an heir, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. And here's the patience and the faith of the saints. And verse 11. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. And he had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke as a dragon. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him, and caused the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he does great wonders, so that he makes fire to come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of the men, and deceives them that dwell on the earth by the means of the miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell in the earth that they should make an image to the beast, which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power, who is he? The second beast, with the two horns, that spoke as a dragon but looked like a lamb. He had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast, this is the first beast now, should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And it goes on to give some additional description, but now let's note a few things here. The beast had seven heads and 10 horns. No description was given of six of the heads. None. One head alone was identified. That's the head of the lion. And then there were horns. No explanation was given. So what can we deduce from this? Either it is not intended for us to understand it, which would seem perhaps contradictory, or we can find an explanation for this elsewhere. And the fact is, we can. Let us go to Daniel. Book of Daniel, chapter 7, and we will see some similarities between this beast of Revelation 13 and what happened in Daniel. Daniel chapter 7, and let's go from verse 2. It says, Daniel spoke and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heavens strove upon the great sea, and four great beasts came up from the sea, different from one another. The first one was like a lion, and had eagle's wings. Let's see the one with the lion. Go back up. We have a beast of a lion with eagle's wings. Let's go back up. Have a lion, go up. Go up. Have a lion with eagle's wings. Going up, up to the top. Lion. Eagle's wings. So, we have a lion with eagle's wings. And I beheld until the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and made to stand upon its feet as a man. And a man's heart was given to him. And behold, another beast, a second beast, like a bear. See the bear. And it raised itself up on one side. Let's go to the next image of the bear. Raising itself up on one side. And it had three ribs in its mouth. And they said unto it, Arise, devour much flesh. And after this I beheld, and lo, another beast, like a leopard. I see the leopard. Which had upon its back four wings like a bird. the beast also had four heads. So the leopard had four heads, and dominion was given unto it. And after this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, strong exceedingly, and had great iron teeth. And it devoured and broke in pieces, and stamped the remnant or the residue with its feet, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. And I beheld, I considered the horns, and behold, there came up amongst them another little horn, before whom there were 3 of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were the eyes like the eyes of a man, and the mouth speaking great things. Then he went on to see what he saw. So now, this is another puzzle. Verse 16, he says, I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit, in the midst of my body. So he came near unto the angel, and he said, I want to know, what does this mean? So he told me and made me to know the interpretation of the things. These three beasts, which are these great beasts, which are four kings, or four kingdoms, which shall arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom, and shall possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. But then I wanted to know the truth of the fourth beast, which was diverse from all the others, and exceedingly dreadful, whose teeth were of iron, and his nails of brass, which devoured and broke in pieces, and stamped the remnant with his feet, and of the 10 horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, and before whom 3 fell, even that of the horn that had eyes, and a mouth that spoke very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows. So let's go to the fourth beast. That there were 4 kingdoms that were to arise. Now what do we have? We have the beast with great iron teeth, 10 horns. We have the leopard with 4 heads. That's one. We have the bear with 1 head. We have the lion, 1 head. So 4 heads of the leopard, 1 of the bear, 1 of the lion at 6, 1 of this beast with great iron teeth, 7 heads, and 10 horns. So let's go back down to the beast of Revelation now. Let's go down to the beast of Revelation. Yeah. What does this beast have? We have the head of a lion. We have the 4 heads of a leopard. We have the head of a bear. And then we have the head with 7 heads. The head of great iron teeth with 10 horns. So the 4 beasts of Daniel somehow now comprise this composite beast. Why and what is the significance of that? Let's go to the next image. The next beast, same image with the beast. Yeah. Good. Now it says one of the heads was wounded to death. What's the significance of that? Well, we've gotten so far. Let me see how much time. I have a few minutes left. We've gotten so far that they were representing the kingdoms.
It says here, back in Daniel 7, it said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the earth, and shall tread it down, and break it in pieces. And the ten horns out of this kingdom are ten kings that shall arise, and another shall arise after them. And he shall be diverse from the first. This new horn that will arise is going to be different from the first ten. And this new horn, he shall speak. Well, before that, and another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first ten, and he shall subdue three kings. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws. And they shall be given into his hand until a time, and times, and dividing of time. And he goes on to give a further prediction. But now, look at some similarities here. This little horn, this other horn, before whom three fell, is going to do essentially the same thing that was said to be of the horn in the head in Revelation 13. The little horn is going to speak great words against the Most High. The beast of Revelation 13, it says here, and there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given to him to continue 42 months. So both the little horn and the beast of Revelation 13 apparently have similar characteristics where it comes to blasphemy and speaking great things. So what can we make of this image so far? In Daniel, they represented four different empires. But here we see all of them combined into one. What does that suggest? Could be that all of the empires were somehow grouped into one empire. How is that possible? Well, we won't have time to do much more today because this is going to be a series. It's very involved. And so that you can follow it slowly and understand it, this is the first installation. But let's just close off with this. In Daniel 6, Daniel 8, we see another imagery here of animals. Verse 3, he said, I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which has two horns. And the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other. And the higher horn came up last. And I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward, so that no beast might stand before him. Neither was there anything that could deliver out of his hand, but he did according to his will and became great. And as I was considering this ram, behold, an he-goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth and touched not the ground. And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. And he came to the ram that had the two horns, which I had seen standing by the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power. And I saw him come close to the ram, and he was moved with anger against him. And he smote the ram, and broke his two horns. And there was no power in the ram to stand before him. But he, the he-goat, cast him to the ground and stamped upon him. And there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand. Therefore the he-goat waxed very great. When he was strong, the great horn was broken.
I think we have an image somewhere here of the he-goats, do we? We'll go up a little further. No? Go up. No, I didn't think perhaps I didn't put it in. Let's go up to the top. No, I didn't put that in just yet.
He said that when he was strong, the great horn was broken, and in his place, or for it, came up four notable horns towards the wind of heaven, and out of one of them came a little horn, which waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and stamped upon them. And he magnified himself even to the prince of the host. And by the daily sacrifice, by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and his sanctuary was cast down. And again, no description here. But let's drop down a little bit further. Let's go down to verse 18. Daniel is speaking to the angel. I was in a deep sleep, my face toward the ground, and he touched me and said, upright, set me upright. And he said, behold, I will make thee to know what shall be the last end of the indignation. For at the appointed time, the end shall be. The ram which you saw, having two horns, are the kings of Media and Persia, or the Medo-Persian Empire. And the rough goat is the king of Grazia, or Greece. And the great horn that is between his eyes is the first king. Now that horn being broken, or this ruler having been died or killed, whereas four stood up for it, those four horns came up, four kingdoms shall stand up out of this nation, but not in his power, meaning not when this notable horn was in power. His power, he was broken, killed, taken out of the way, and after him, four kingdoms of his one kingdom are going to emerge. And at the latter time, it says, you know, you shall come to the full. Don't want to get into that today, but this is what we want to clarify. The beast that we're seeing here, it says, the four heads represent an empire. We're seeing here that the Medo-Persian Empire, which was represented by a ram with two horns, was defeated in military terms by a ram, by a goat, a he-goat with a notable horn. And it says the rough goat is the king of Grazia, or Greece. And the history will tell us that the Medes and the Persians were defeated by the Greco-Macedonian Empire. That was at the time led by Alexander the Great. He was the first ruler, the notable horn. He was a warrior. He used to actually take sword and go out and fight and stuff. And he led the army that defeated the Medes and the Persians. I heard someone say, the Medes and the Persians had an army of over a million people. And Alexander the Great, with an army that was much smaller than that, was somehow able to rob them. An army of about 40,000 men. They were very fierce, apparently, and he used a stratagem whereby
they covered themselves with shields, and they had extremely long spears, and they kept interchanging. So the front row would go in front and then retreat, and the back rows would come, and this is how they would approach. And apparently that probably scared the Medo-Persian Empire, and they defeated them.
But it says, the horn being broken.
Alexander the Great died as a young man, about age 32. Some say it was some alcohol poisoning out of a drunken orgy. Because I remember reading a book when I was small, when I was a boy, maybe about Karim's age or so. In narrating the exploits of Alexander the Great, he just wanted to go and conquer territory. But his army rebelled against him. It said they longed to see the hills of Macedonia again. They had been out there fighting for so many years. They hadn't been home to see their families, to see their friends, to see their wives, to see familiar environments. And they rebelled. We want to go home. Because of that, the empire stopped just on the border of India. And because Alexander the Great could not conquer any further, he went to this drunk and killed himself with alcohol poison. So what we're seeing here is a composite beast, the beast of Daniel. Represented in Revelation in one beast. And thus let me leave you with this. Recognize one thing, that what we're being given are snapshots in time. They don't extend to much more than that, but we've been given a snapshot in time so that the beast, for argument's sake, with the ram, snapshot in time, is telling us the Greco-Macedonian Empire will defeat the Medo-Persian Empire. That's a snapshot. What we're seeing in Revelation 13 is this new empire and its relationship to the little horn, or the beast with the two horns that spoke as a dragon but look like a lamb. The relationship that existed between this composite beast, this conglomeration of empires, and this little beast with the two horns. That is what we see. Now, exactly how this all fits together, we will leave for another occasion. But let me just have you remember that what we're seeing here are snapshots in time. So on the next occasion, whenever Dale schedules me, we will continue with this. And I want to go in detail, brethren, because it's important for us. Because there's a prophecy that says in Daniel, in Revelation 13, that this beast that we see here represented with the seven heads and ten horns. And you'll see why it has seven heads and ten horns. It says that he exercises the power of the first beast and causes as many, causes them which dwell in the earth to worship this beast. Worship not necessarily meaning we kneel down and pray, but you accept whatever it says or does, his rights. And therefore, it says he had means by the miracles of the first beast, which he had to do in his beast sight, saying to them that dwell in the earth that they should make an image to the beast, which had the womb by the sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the beast, the image of the beast, should be killed. So it could affect us. And he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand,
or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark of the beast, or the name of the beast, and the number of his name. So it's important to us, man. But at another time, when you see this, just remember where you are. So take good notes. Next time, we are going to see what this composite thing represents and how it came to be.